This podcast is brought to you by Whisper, the digital communication platform that's changing the game for local governments. Whisper makes it easy to boost community engagement and keep citizens informed through SMS, email, social media, voice messaging, and more, all from the one platform. Better yet, it's easy to use and requires no technical skills. To find out more, head to whisper.com. That's WHISPIR.com.
Hey y'all, coming to you from Jacksonville, Florida, this is GovLove, a podcast about local government brought to you by engaging local government leaders. I'm Ben Kittelson, Senior Consultant at RefTelus and GovLove co-host. We have a great episode for today where we're talking politics versus administration. But first, the best way to support GovLove is to become an ELGL member. ELGL is a professional association engaging the brightest minds in local government. And mark your calendars, ELGL's annual conference is coming up this fall, October 13th and 14th in Phoenix, Arizona. You can learn more about the conference and register by going to elgl.org/elgl22. Now, let me introduce today's guest. Dr. Kimberly Nelson is a professor of public administration and government at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. She joined the School of Government in 2013 and has published her research in Public Administration Review, State and Local Review, and the American Review of Public Administration. She conducts training on leadership and management topics and is the co-author of the book, Managing Local Government, An Essential Guide for Municipal and County Managers. She was also on the podcast, the year is escaping me, but we'll find it. But she was also on the podcast to share some research about the diversity of folks in local government, especially in terms of gender diversity. So we'll make sure to link to that episode in the notes for the show. But with that, Dr. Nelson, welcome to GovLove. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Cool. Well, as you know, one of the ways we kind of get started on episodes is with a lightning round to get to know our guests a little better. I went back and listened to the old episodes, so I make sure I'm not asking you the same questions. But okay. But what was the first album that you bought?
Well, this will date me, but it was Synchronicity by The Police.
Oh, nice. Okay. does that still get any play? Any does that still appear in the rotation?
Oh, I still like Police. I always will.
Awesome. What was the last movie you saw in theaters or streamed?
Well, we actually just took my 10-year-old stepson to see the new Minions movie over the weekend, so that was quite exciting.
Nice. What was your review of? Of it.
I thought it was good. It was cute. I hadn't seen all of the previous movies though, so maybe I missed out on something. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Nice. Awesome. And then, you know, I lived in Carrboro for a while next door to Chapel Hill, but I'm always curious about people's favorite restaurant spot. So what's your favorite local food spot in Chapel Hill?
Well,
area generally.
Right. I was very disappointed that Crook's Corner closed during the pandemic, yeah. And I'm hopeful that it will eventually reopen. So now my favorite place is a place called Acme that has locally sourced food, and it's really good.
That's a great spot. Great date night spot for sure. Mm-hmm. Awesome. And then my last lightning question for you, where do you go for inspiration?
I guess the North Carolina Museum of Art is somewhere I go quite a bit. I really like that museum. The gardens are very nice, the outdoor area as well as the indoor galleries.
Nice. Cool. Yeah, that is a great museum. All right. So one thing I always like to ask folks when I come on the podcast is kind of their career path. And so although you don't work in local government, I'm still interested in how you ended up doing kind of, academic work in this field and in public administration. So how'd you end up kind of getting interested in this field and end up at the University of North Carolina?
So I originally got an MPA degree thinking I would do something in public health. And then I got pregnant with my daughter. So instead of working, I decided to do something with my free time that I thought I was going to have. I would get my PhD in public administration. I really didn't know the challenges that awaited trying to juggle a newborn and a PhD program at the time.
Yeah.
But I worked with Jim Savara at North Carolina State University, who is quite well known in local government management scholarship. And I just caught a bug for a local government management study from that point. And I've always wanted to come back to North Carolina, and I really enjoy the school of government because of its commitment to improving governance in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. And so I really like the balance between the academic work and the practitioner side.
Yeah. Yeah. And the school government is so active in the state too, which between trainings and all sorts of, and that being a resource, which, so it's a great model for other programs across the country. So I'm curious, you know, you've been at the school government for a while now. How have you, or before we dive into, you know, the main reason I wanted to have you on, but how has like the teaching about local government or public administration generally changed kind of in your time at UNC? Have you noticed anything that's changed about, you know, the way you approach this topic with students?
It hasn't changed too much because I've always really been concerned with ensuring that the students have a really good foundation of knowledge that will help them in their future careers in local government management. Mm-hmm. I'm really concerned with making sure that they understand the roles and responsibilities and the terminology before they go out to interview. And mm-hmm. I think the only difference is that most of my students are going to stay in North Carolina. So I do have to be conscious to make sure that they understand North Carolina law and practice, but I also try to give them a national focus as well in case they don't stay in the state. Mm.
Yeah, I imagine that's difficult because North Carolina is so, all the local governments are the same, which is nice. It makes it very easy, at least like structurally.
Right.
Teaching for other states, it's a little different. So how do you weave that in, I guess?
Yeah, so I often pull out the outliers that are weird, like New mm-hmm. Jersey, and talk about how different they are from North Carolina. I also like to talk to them about how you can sort of categorize states by different classifications. You know, North Carolina is very centralized and it has a small number of local governments. And you'll look at other states like Illinois that's very decentralized, has a lot of local governments. And of course, the union versus non-union mm-hmm. states is another important difference to look at.
Mm. Yeah. And then I'm curious, has the kind of topics that your students kind of gravitate towards or are interested in, has that changed at all in kind of your time at UNC?
I think the policy areas they're interested in has changed a little bit. I think mm-hmm. they've always been interested in what's a career in local government management really going to be like. They're very concerned mm-hmm. about that, of course. Policy-wise, it seems right now that students are very concerned with sustainability and development. Mm-hmm.
So have you guys had to create more, I don't know, courses around that? Or how do you kind of weave something in when that's, because I would say that's probably something that I've noticed just, you know, doing this podcast, that development and, you know, sustainability and resilience, like those are topics that local governments are working on too. It's not right. like it's only your students being interested in it. So how do you kind of work new stuff into the, into the curriculum like that?
Well, I think one thing that makes us a little different from other programs is that our students can really customize their courses of study. Mm-hmm. They can pick and choose from other departments on campus, so the environmental studies or the development and planning. And we also have some cross-listed courses with those departments. So, you know, we try to make sure that our students are aware of what's available around campus and as well as opportunities for what we call our professional work experience or an internship mm-hmm. that may help them meet those interests.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I'll stop pestering you about kind of what your students are thinking. But the reason I wanted to have you on the podcast was for a recent article you wrote that we'll be sure to link to in the notes here. It was called Returning to the Politics versus Administration Debate. So as maybe a way to kind of start our conversation, what made you want to write this article? What's it about broadly? Like just kind of set the stage for our listeners, I guess.
Yeah, so it's a pretty short piece that just makes the case that local government managers have a valuable role in the policy process. And it's a role they really shouldn't shy away from. One reason I chose the topic is because I had noticed at a couple of different events, managers talking about how they avoided the policy process as much as they could. And it concerned me because that really isn't the best choice to have optimal quality local governance. And so I wanted to just put it back out there that it's okay to have this role in the policy process, and managers have always had a role in the policy process. And so, they should embrace it.
Yeah. Yeah, I know I've definitely worked for managers where they want to stay as far away from that as possible.
Right.
And others that are like maybe closer to what you describe, and we'll get into some of the details here in a second. But so what were some of the, is there an example of like what someone would say or what their approach would be that you're like, this is actually not what we mean when we're talking about politics and administration?
Well, you know, one manager simply said, don't get engaged in policy to a group of new managers that I was listening to. And just directly said, stay away from policy entirely. Yeah. And, first of all, I don't see how that's even possible. I really don't understand that at all. But second of all, I think that the managers have an essential role really to play in the policy process.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, and you do this in the article too, but there's a distinction between the politics and the policy process, right? Like you can be involved in the policy process, while not being political. Right.
Right. Yeah. And that's where the sort of misinformation around, the idea that there was a dichotomy got started. When Woodrow Wilson wrote his dissertation, he talked about a dichotomy between politics and administration. And at the time, given the sort of cultural environment that existed, you know, it was the time of scientific management, and it was called the period of orthodoxy. It was really the birth of real public administration. And it was also during the machine era, so there was a lot of corruption. And so you can't just look at what Woodrow Wilson wrote without looking at the context in which he wrote it. And so, in fact, what we know today is that what he's talking about was staying out of the partisan political process, the machine politics. And he was not arguing that managers should not have a role in the policy, or that public administrators more broadly should not have a role in the policy process. And actually, recently, I've done research both alone and in partnership with Jim Savara, where we traced local government managers' writings from the beginning of the profession and what they said about their role in policy. And they were very clear that it was an important role, even in the early 1900s. So this isn't something that has suddenly trended, that managers have shifted from no policy role to a policy role.
Yeah.
They've always had a role.
Yeah. What was that role? I'm curious, like from your research, what was that kind of early role in that policymaking process?
Well, that part's kind of interesting. And you have to look at the context back then too, because early managers, a lot of them were engineers. They were very much concerned with infrastructure. So, you know, when the council manager form was first created, there were very few paved roads and very few systems to provide clean water and sewage disposal. And so the early managers really were concerned with getting municipalities in particular to become safe places with high quality of life. And so they had a different role. So they were engaged in the policy process from this sort of professional standpoint, where they advised the board about these needs that the community had. The way the role has shifted is interesting. So the role has shifted some. Today's managers do have a more community-minded role. And of course, this will vary from community to community, depending on the preferences of the elected officials and the personalities all involved, how broad that role may be. But most managers today do have some forward-facing responsibilities that where they're actually out as and speaking to the community and serving community leadership role too.
Interesting. So they're doing more of an engagement function than like a engineering type function.
Right.
In their day-to-day. Yeah. Huh. That's fascinating. Well, and one of the things that I think you said in the article is you called it like unrealistic that managers could be separate from the policymaking. Why do you think that is? Like if there was a manager out there who feels that like that's not his role or it's not their role, like why is that unrealistic that they can never be part of the policy process?
Well, I mean, for one, where else would elected officials get policy advice if the staff and the managers? And so, you know, elected officials really rely on the manager and staff to provide advice and guidance on policy issues. Mm-hmm. And the other part of that role is that they are bringing evidence into an inherently political process.
Yeah.
So this would hopefully allow elected officials to see past partisan differences and make decisions based on the best interests of the community, based on factual evidence presented by manager and staff.
Mm. Yeah. Can you say more about that? Cause I do think that's really key. What you just said, that like part of your job as a staff is to give elected officials good information to make decisions on what, and that's a key role in policymaking, whether we want to admit it or not.
Right. And, you know, if you think about a time where you've witnessed a board meeting where people weren't agreeing, oftentimes the question that gets them or the way that they get past that is either they ask the manager or staff for more research, or the manager steps in and says, you know, since it looks like we're not really able to move forward at this time, what if I go and get these points of information for you? And then we can come back and discuss this later. So really, although the manager doesn't have a formal role on the board, the manager, by being there to advise them and present these facts, really allows them oftentimes to get past squabbles among council members.
So, you know, one of the things you talk about is the politics administration dichotomy and kind of how that's kind of carried forward. And, you know, in some ways we're misinterpreting it when we think about managers or staff not having a role in the policymaking process. But why do you think that dichotomy or that framework has persisted? Why is that something that, you know, we carry forward? And even if it's not, like we've talked about already, like it's not realistic or not necessarily the reality that people are dealing with.
Well, I mean, it's hard to say really, except I do believe some MPA programs present the Wilson piece at its face, and they don't really go into the debate that has since occurred about considering the context in which he wrote that piece. And so I do think that some people come out of an MPA program believing it's real. You know, and then there are managers who really, maybe they serve divisive boards. Maybe their personality is such that they just really don't want to be in the middle of political infighting. And it's not that they should be in the middle of it. They shouldn't. But perhaps in some places where situation is particularly divisive, it's easier for them to just step back from the policymaking process rather than wade into it in their appropriate role.
And I know you touched on this earlier, but what is that context that people get wrong about some of the, like the Woodrow Wilson piece, or what should we be taking when we think about the politics administration dichotomy? Like what is that context that we ought to be thinking about to give it that full picture of the time rather than just what it says on its face?
Yeah, well, so the, you know, ICMA Code of Ethics actually lays out the dangers of city and county managers engaging in any kind of actual politics. When Woodrow Wilson wrote his dissertation, it was the progressive era, and machines ran the cities. And so that's what he was talking about. He was talking about these political machines, and that, you know, and it, he wasn't just talking about local government, of course, he was talking about the state and federal government as well. And he really believed that, you know, in order to be considered competent and to not be accused of sort of favoritism for one party over the other, the manager or the administrator had to avoid that. Mm-hmm. But really, he was talking about avoiding anything related to partisan politics or the machine politics at the time.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah, I wanted to make sure I got that right. All right. So I'm curious, you know, one of the things, one of the reasons that I think your article resonated with me was that I feel like I've noticed a trend in the last few years of local government becoming more partisan and more political. And I think that, I know that puts staff on edge at times. And I think managers that, you know, see themselves as, you know, apolitical or nonpartisan and don't want to get kind of weighed into all that, I can see why they would, you know, start stepping back from policymaking discussions. But how do you think staff or managers should think about being part of the policymaking process, but also, as you know, our local governments get kind of maybe more partisan and more political, staying out of that political fray, you know, like Woodrow Wilson's talking about in the, with that context, like, how do you think we'd balance that?
It's a really huge challenge right now. And I think that even the most careful managers, those who really try very hard to limit their role in the policy process, can sometimes be accused of taking sides. We've heard many times of a new set of elected officials coming in and blaming the manager for policies that they may or may not have recommended, but that's irrelevant because during their tenure, the policy was passed, and so the manager's blamed for that. So it's not always avoidable. However, you know, again, if the manager is relying on facts, evidence, research, their own experience, and keeps policy discussions based on evidence as opposed to ideology, that's very helpful. Also, unless there's absolutely only one option that is in the best interest of the community, the manager should try and staff should try to present multiple options to the board so that they can make the choice. Now, there will be times when the manager truly believes that there's no support for other options, and in that case, you know, may make a risky recommendation. But that doesn't mean they shouldn't make that recommendation if they truly believe it's in the best interest of the community.
No, that's a really good point. Well, I think something you said earlier there that made me think was like the status quo is a policy choice too, right? To try and stay out of it, like you're choosing an option as well. Like it's a political and policy choice to be like, we don't want to do anything.
That's a great point. Absolutely.
Yeah. Interesting. So if you know, this traditional kind of politics administration dichotomy is maybe too simple of a framework to think about kind of the role of staff or the role of a manager, like how do you teach this, or how do you think about kind of what the role should be or the framework to talk about this role if that dichotomy is maybe too simplistic?
Yeah, so I like to talk about how boards have personalities. And every time there's an election, even if one member of the board changes, it's quite likely that the overall personality of the board is going to change as well. And so we really need to think of these roles as somewhat fluid, because in some cases you will have a board that is very hands-off and the manager actually tries to, you know, sort of push the board to be more active. And in those cases, the manager's role in the policy process may be greater than what's average. In other cases, a manager may have a board full of attorneys and people who used to work in or have or currently work in business management who are executives who are very educated and are very engaged, and they want to have a broader role in the administrative side. And not to say that they should step into the administrator's role, because that's not what I'm saying, but mm-hmm. they will show more interest in what's happening on the administrative side than the average board. And so there's a little bit of fluidity there that's dependent on the personalities and the strengths and weaknesses of all the people involved, as well as what the elected officials' preferences are about the manager's role. So some boards may say, we want you to be the person who speaks to the media, and we want you to be the face of the government under these circumstances. In other cases, they may say, no, we want one of the board members to always be the face of the community, and so, or the mayor. And so that's another important factor. What does the board want? What are their preferences as far as that are the certain roles of the manager?
And how do you think, you know, someone in a manager seat or someone on a board, like, should go about kind of establishing what those roles should be, or identifying that personality as you talked about?
Well, I mean, I think the manager should do a board orientation procedure whenever there's an election. There should be some sort of retreat where they get members up to speed on important policy areas for the community. But they're also learning about those elected officials and what their preferences are and what their interests are. Mm-hmm. And then on the side of a manager, you know, I can't overstate the importance of an annual evaluation for a manager.
Yeah.
I'm always surprised at communities that don't do this. And it really is an opportunity to open a dialogue about what the elected officials want to see in the manager, what they think he or she is doing well, and what they think he or she needs to improve on. And I really do think that these conversations that come out of the annual evaluation process are extremely important to having a high functioning board manager relationship.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. It's an ongoing conversation because the personality may change too. And so having these kind of touch points helps managers navigate that and helps boards manage better.
Right.
What about staff? So, like, obviously, you know, as personality changes on the board, the manager's role will shift. And like you said, we don't necessarily want elected bodies to be, you know, doing some of the day-to-day operations. But do you think kind of the staff under a manager, like their role in the policy process changes as these personalities of the board change?
Less so than the manager, but certainly, you know, if the board is very hands off, then, you know, that may seem like a good thing at first, but really think about it. That means that staff is sort of flying blind. They're not really sure what the elected officials want. And so that guidance is very important. So you really don't want to be at either end of the spectrum. You want to be somewhere in the middle, but the staff role doesn't really change, but the staff comfort level, I think, would change depending on how activist or how, you know, laid hands off, I guess is the word, the board would be.
Yeah. Well, I imagine it might also depend a little bit on the expertise of the specific manager where, you know, if they don't have a lot of knowledge in the like affordable housing or something, and that's an area where there's a lot of policy opportunity, maybe, you know, they that person becomes more active or something like that.
Right. Well, and they do, of course, all boards really, or most boards, I shouldn't say all, but most boards do show greater concern with public safety departments than other departments, mm-hmm. particularly mm-hmm. policing. And so, you know, And the police chief usually is a well-known person in the community. And so you will see that the board is more concerned with staff members, particularly chiefs of police and fire.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. So one of the things your article talked about was a flight analogy framework. So I'll let you explain it, but what is that? Where did that come from? And can you just talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's easier to understand if you're actually looking at it when we're talking about it. It's a graphic that was developed by Mike Baker. He's a manager in Downers Grove, Illinois. Mm-hmm. And he posted it in the offices so that people could see these shifting boundaries between policy and administrative roles of the manager and elected officials. So the easiest way to describe it is with the flight analogy. If you think of a plane at cruising altitude, and it has the overall broad vision of the community in mind, that's where the board has greater responsibility than manager and staff. And then as you come down to land where policy is implemented, that's the purview of the manager and staff. And then in between, what you see is a shared set of responsibilities as you go closer and closer to implementation of policy. Mm.
Yeah, I think I really like this framework. We'll be sure to link to it for our listeners. So the kind of post for this episode, we'll put a link to it. But I really like this framework because like you said, I think usually we think about the high level council role and then the day-to-day, like on the ground implementation of each end of the spectrum, but we don't think about kind of that blurring in the middle. And that there is probably a role for electeds in that a little, because I'm curious, I don't know if you have an example or if there's a way to talk about maybe one of those middle pieces where it's like, you know, normally in a, or not normally, but in a framework where the council is only setting a high level strategic object, like or policy making kind of role, you know, they wouldn't have any role kind of as the plane lands. But what are maybe one of those middle ones where it's like they should have some input here? Maybe it's not just up to them. It's, you know, staff and manager are in there too. But because I'm curious about that, because I think usually I know it was framed to me when I went through my MPA program and manager that I've worked for, that the council sets that strategic direction, that high level, you know, 30,000 foot level. But then they're kind of, that's kind of the end of it. And so I think that framework around having a blurring until you get down to like the actual implementation was interesting. So I don't know. I just want to talk about maybe that gray area, I guess.
Okay. Well, I mean, if you think about actually a high quality strategic planning process.
Yeah.
The visioning and the goal setting is primarily the purview of the board. But it's all informed by the staff.
Yeah.
So the staff has a role. So for example, if the board wants to have a goal around affordable housing, then part of the strategic planning process at the retreat would hopefully be staff members presenting on the status of affordable housing in the community, what best practices are around the country, talking about, you know, some options that they are currently pursuing and what they're hoping to pursue in the future. All of that information is used by the board to frame the goals that they'll put forward into the strategic plan, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's the role of staff is limited there because they're not actually constructing the goals, but they're giving them the information they need to structure the goals. So that's one example. And as you go through the process, the staff role broadens and broadens. You know, they're the ones who frame the strategies usually, but the board may be informing the strategic choices they make through the budgeting process because they're going to approve or disapprove of certain, you know, programs that are going to be put forward to implement the strategic plan.
Well, and I think, I mean, to your point, like that's okay. Like that back and forth, right? That blurring where it's not, there's not like this dichotomy between the two. Like having a brain is good. Yeah.
That's right. They to function best, they really need great communication and trust, and they have to really believe that the elected officials are in it for the right reasons, and the staff are there to help them do their jobs better.
Yeah, awesome. So I'm curious, you know, your article's, I think, went out maybe a month ago now. Have you gotten any feedback or pushback from any managers in the field or other academics?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I've heard more feedback on this than any other article I've written. And it's all been positive, actually. A number of managers are planning to use the article for different purposes. And, you know, I've heard a lot of them saying that, you know, I agree with this. This is spot on. You're right. And I'm so happy you wrote this. And so I've gotten a lot of positive feedback. And I was kind of actually surprised, because usually when you write an academic piece, I don't know who reads it, but mostly only other academics. And so you don't hear a lot about it. But with this one, it seemed to resonate quite a bit with the managers.
Yeah, it's maybe putting a finger on something or I don't know, highlighting something that they feel day to day that isn't often reflected in the literature, maybe. Yeah. Interesting. Cool. Well, anything else about kind of this article or this topic, like anything else that we should be thinking about as we, you know, staff members for local governments think about our role versus the elected official role?
Yeah. I mean, I think it is important to do all the upfront work of building relationships between council and staff and the manager, for the manager to set the expectations with staff of their roles, and for the council to be clear about what they want from the manager and to follow through. There's really nothing worse, I think, than for a manager than being told one thing by an elected board and then the manager following through on what they were told, and then the board saying, oh, we actually didn't want you to do that. I think it is important that when board members, you know, give direction, that that they stick with that. And if they change their minds, that's fine. But they can't blame the manager for following through with what they originally said.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's not a good situation for a manager to be in, and it's really not fair.
Yeah. So I'm curious, I know the school government does a lot of training for elected officials. How does this kind of resonate with folks, like thinking about kind of that, you know, that manager role in the policymaking process, or just kind of that relationship with staff generally? Or because I know one of the reasons I ask is I think, you know, in my time in local government, some of that bleeding has occurred between that like manager and council role. And so what's kind of been, you know, the shift that you've seen, or maybe you haven't seen a shift, but what's the, I guess, reaction from some of the electeds that you've worked with around kind of this topic?
Yeah. So as you said earlier, North Carolina is unique in that they have the School of Government, and we do training for new elected officials every year called Essentials. And in the Essentials program, one of the portions of it is sort of working with others section.
Yeah.
And we actually use the flight analogy, and we say all the things managers want to say, but maybe kind of uncomfortable saying to their new board members. But we try to really make it clear that it's critically important that there's mutual respect and trust, and that that the manager is there to make them look good, and that they should, you know, try to have as healthy a relationship as they can with their manager and staff. You know, when there's no trust between the elected officials and the manager or staff, you know, you cannot have a functioning local government at that point. Mm-hmm. And so that's a really important message that we try to get out, that you need to respect the roles and responsibilities. And in North Carolina, you know, boards have no personnel function at all on the council manager form. And so they have to respect those roles. At the same time, the manager is very interested in making sure that their interests are met. And so, but the manager can't read their mind. So they have to tell the manager what those interests are.
Yeah. Yeah. Interesting. Cool. Awesome. Well, before we kind of wrap up, I'm just curious, what are you working on next? Is there any research that our listeners should be on the lookout for coming from you?
Well, my biggest project right now is a book I'm writing with my colleague, Whitney Afonso, on corruption in municipal government.
Ooh.
And it's a follow-up to an article we published a few years ago in Public Administration Review. Mm-hmm. And we look at corruption nationally between 1990 and 2020, and in all cities with populations of at least 10,000. And so it's a huge data set.
Yeah.
In the initial article, we found that the council manager form was highly protective from corruption risk. And we expect to find that in the broader data set. And then the book will finish out with some case studies that sort of highlight the findings from the statistical analysis.
Interesting. So a couple questions on that then, since you brought it up. So what kind of data set, like how do you come up with data for that, I guess? Like, is that just like kind of figuring out what kind of corruption prosecutions there have been nationally, or is it like news stories, or where does that kind of data come from?
Yeah, so that's the tricky part. With this, there's a reason this has never been done before. Mm-hmm. We had to build original data, and we used federal government data from the Department of Justice on corruption convictions. That's how we only include corruption convictions or plea mm-hmm. deals. So someone has to actually have either been convicted or admitted to being corrupt, because that's for certain, you know.
Yeah.
There's a lot more corruption that we're not capturing, of course, which is one weakness of our study, because some people are guilty who don't get convicted, and small cases don't show up. We do flesh out that data set with news articles as well. So mm-hmm. we do both a government record search and a news article search for corruption. And find the convictions that way. But we are missing a lot of cases, because one interesting thing that we found is that very few local governments pursue small cases of, you know, embezzlement, small amounts of money. They rarely actually engage in that, in any kind of prosecution for that. And the other challenge is that not all states have state laws that distinguish public corruption from private sector corruption. So embezzlement is embezzlement, bribery is bribery. And so gathering state data is close to impossible.
Yeah.
At least for all of the states, it is impossible. And it's challenging to even get a cohort of the states together.
Interesting.
But the data set is the worst part. It's a huge data set. It's a monster data set, because it's longitudinal. So each case is a city year, 30 years per city in 7,000 plus cities.
Wow. Yeah. And then
I'm sorry, it's 3,000 plus cities, not 7,000.
That's still a lot.
Yeah.
And then, not to give away the ending of your book, but is there an example you can share of one of the case studies where this is how it played out in a council manager form versus another form of government?
Well, I haven't written the case studies yet. One example is that's recent is Cincinnati. Mm. A couple of years ago, almost all their new elected officials were arrested. And Cincinnati actually is what I would describe as a hybrid government. It's not a pure council manager form. And so there are some questions about that. That will actually show up in our data set as council manager form. But yet, I believe that some of the political elements added into the form of government are the reason that it was susceptible to corruption.
Interesting. Interesting. Very cool. So we'll have to stay tuned for the book. And, you know, when you publish, you're always welcome back to GovLove to talk about it. So awesome. Our traditional last question for an episode is usually the hardest, but if you could be the GovLove DJ and pick the exit music for this interview, what song would you pick?
Well, so my co-author Whitney wanted to title our book Hot Town, Corruption in the City, but the publisher said no way. So to make her feel a little better, I would choose Hot Town, Summer in the City.
Awesome. Yeah. And I think there's a heat index warning across most of the country this week. So I think it's very appropriate. Awesome. Well, that ends our episode for today. Dr. Nelson, thank you so much for coming on and talking with me and sharing your expertise and all your work. This has been a fascinating conversation.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. And for our listeners, GovLove is brought to you by engaging local government leaders. And the best way to support GovLove is to become an ELGL member. You can reach us online by going to elgl.org/govlove or on Twitter at the handle @govlovepodcast. And you can subscribe to GovLove on your favorite podcast app. And if you're already subscribed, go tell a friend or colleague about this podcast. Help us spread the word that GovLove is the go-to place for local government stories. And with that, thank you for listening. This has been GovLove, a podcast about local government. But at night it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on, if that's all night. Just like the heat, it'll be all right. And babe, don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer, in the city, in the summer, in the city.